Hi guys, this is Professor Harsh Kacharya, and today we are meeting for a very, very, very important and a specific purpose, that is revision test paper for July 2020 exams. Well, we are not very sure whether the exams are going to be there in July 2020 or not, but let's be prepared, right? So if at all exams are there, we should be well prepared for the exams. Okay, so before I start, I would just like to give the best of my wishes and prayers for all of you and all of your families, because guys, I understand it is a very, very hard time that we are all going through, and especially the students who are still in the dilemma whether we should write the exams or not write the exams. But all my prayers and blessings are with all of you. Okay, so without wasting any more time, I am starting the discussion of RTP for July 2020 CA final new syllabus law paper. All right, now I just want to clear one thing. In the RTP, there are amendments also given. Okay, for the amendments, I have already recorded a separate video and posted it on YouTube. It is available with the notes applicable to the amendments. Everything is there. Okay, so everything is there on YouTube itself. And I am particularly recording this video in English right now, because if I record in Hindi, my other students from the southern part of India are not able to, not able to catch up with it. So if I do it in English, I'm sure 90% each and every student will be able to catch up with it. Okay, so majority of the crowd will be able to understand, majority of my students will be able to understand and correlate with it. Okay, I will try to record in Hindi also and post it again, but I am also facing some issues with respect to the technology and availability. Today it was possible, so I just grabbed an opportunity and here I am recording the RTP for all of you. Okay, so here we are. As you can see, the RTP on your screen, okay, this particular RTP, first thing that we are going to do is an integrated case law or integrated case scenario. Okay, this is how the exams are going to be conducted. They are going to start every particular paper, especially our law paper, okay, with integrated case studies. Now, what is an integrated case study? See, this is a whole case study, as you can see on your screen, correct? This whole case study is there, whole case study is there, whole case study is there, and then you have multiple choice questions specifically for that case study, where question number one is there with four options. Then you have question number two again with similar options. Yes, three and so on. Correct. So first let us go through the case study. What is the case all about? Okay. So I am going to read out the case. I'm going to read out the case and listen to me very, very carefully as I'm reading this case. Okay. Why am I saying that? Whenever you read any case, there are some things which you have to remember and some things which you have to mark. Okay, so you need to understand very, very clearly as to which case is trying to tell you what particular point. For example, when I'm saying Laghus Transport Services Limited, first thing that I'm going to highlight over here is limited. Means this is not a private company. That is what I understood till now. Correct? This is not a private company. Fine. Now what is it? It is a public company. But is it listed or unlisted? That we do not. Let's see further. Is operating in logistics and a public transport domain. Okay. The company has a pan-India presence. So this company is working all over India. All over India they have their offices. As per its articles of association. Okay. The company can appoint maximum 15 directors. So even if it is not as per the articles of association, if you remember section 149, maximum number of directors are 15 only allowed, correct? And all of them shall be rotational directors. Fine. So that is just a condition that all the directors shall be rotational directors. Now, one way when we say all the directors shall be rotational directors, what does that mean? If your concepts are clear, If you have been with me for my classes, you will be aware. If your concepts are clear, then also you will be aware. Directors, when we do under section 152, retirement by rotation, we take the total strength minus the independent directors and those particular type of directors, we get total directors, correct? From that total directors, we take 2/3. Those 2/3 are known as rotational directors, correct? And of the 2/3, we then take 1/3 who will actually ultimately retire from our company. So here, what we have to do? When they are saying all of them should be rotational directors, so it means that whatever directors have to be there, they have to be rotational only. So we will be taking 1/3 only if they are rotational only, correct? So if they say all of them are not rotational, then what will you do? Then we will take 2/3, then 1/3. Let's see. Such question will come. We will answer. Okay, fine. Presently, the company has a strength of 14 directors. Okay, existing is 14. Of which 9 are executive, remaining 5 are non-executive. Okay, so that is a breakup given for your directors, 14 directors, 9 and 5, fine. 31st March 2018 is the date they are giving. Paid up share capital, 8.42 crores, turnover, 84 crores, outstandings, 42 crores. So, if I have to write over here, as per the conditions that we remember, okay. See, this is paid up share capital 8.42 crores. So that is less than rupees 10 crores. Because condition for appointment of independent director, if you remember, minimum paid up share capital should be 10 crores. Or turnover. How much is the turnover? They are saying 84 crores. So condition is what? Should be how much? This is less than 10 crores. This is how much? Less than rupees 100 crores. Correct? This is less than 10 crores. So no ID required. Less than 100 crores. So again, I will say no ID required. And this is 42 crores, which is less than rupees 50 crores. So, no ID is required. Conditions, of course, paid up share capital and the turnover are going to be greater than equal to, that we have to check, correct? And outstanding is going to be exceeding or greater than only. But just for the sake of our understanding, I'm writing here because all the three are not satisfying any of the conditions. So, as of 31st March 2018, independent director is not required. Okay, fine. Let's see. Why are we even seeing for independent directors, guys? Because as we saw, it is a limited company. If it was private limited, the condition itself is not applicable. So we wouldn't have seen only. Correct? Next, the AGM. The AGM held on 20th August 2018. Okay. So they had an AGM on the 20th of August 2018. That was for the year ended 31st March 2018. Anil Badal Chanchal Damodar. Forget it. A, B, C, D. Okay. So A, B, C, D were appointed in place of M, N, O, P. Fine. Four in, four out. No problem. Four in, four out. It is to be noted that earlier a motion authorizing the appointment of A, B, C, D by single resolution was passed in the meeting and not a single vote was cast against them. What is this? If you remember the concepts we have done in the class, single resolution for appointing more than one directors. Yes, single resolution for appointment of more than one directors, meaning we are talking about the concept under section 162 over here. Correct? Okay. As on 31st March 2019, that is next year, they are saying turnover increased. Ta-dang, ta-dang, ta-dang. Turnover, they are saying increased to how much? 120, which is more than 100 crores. So condition attracted. Aggregate outstanding less than 40. Paid up share capital also will be same only. Correct? Yes, paid up share capital same. Fine. Due to the increased turnover, which has crossed 100 crores, what they have to do is two independent directors are to be appointed. Where is it given, sir? Where is it given? Section 149. So if you are using my main book or my summary notes also, okay, if at all you are using my summary notes also, make sure all these things are there in our notes. Okay, each and every question that I am discussing right now is there in our notes. Okay, everything is there in summary notes. More detailed explanation is given in our main book also. Understood? So nothing is there from outside. All these concepts are already covered. Only the thing is they have combined everything and made a case study out of it. Correct? So there is nothing that you cannot do over here. Am I right? Okay, perfect. Let's see what else they are saying. Since the company was required to appoint two independent directors, minimum two is required, the total strength of the board would go up to 16. Yes, definitely it would go up to 16. But as we remember, maximum can be 15. And company has already appointed how many? 14. Correct. So there is place for only one now. Correct. But can you appoint more than one? Yes, sir. How? By passing a special resolution in general meeting. How do you know? We have written it in our notes. Correct. So 16 directors. Okay, would go up to 16 directors from the present 14. The company can have maximum of 15 directors as per the articles. We know that any which ways. Correct. So accordingly, the articles were altered. The strength was increased to 20. Doesn't matter. Even if you increase the strength to 25 or 30, after 15, you anyways have to pass a special resolution. Am I right? Correct. After altering the articles, the company proceeded to appoint 4 independent directors. Oh, minimum 2 are required, but company appointed 4. Company appointed 4 independent directors. Fantastic. Instead of the mandatorily required 2, it felt there was a need. It would strengthen the corporate governance of the company to that extent. Fine. Independent directors. Who are the independent directors? So technically, if you see from here, they are giving you introduction of the independent directors. Correct? Till here. You can read. The names are given. Time pass. No use. Not worth. Subsequent to the above developments, that is after the above developments, the time to hold AGM approached and it was held on the 12th of August 2019. You must hold AGM before the 30th of September every year. Am I right? Correct? At the registered office of the company at Mumbai. So this is the question. Let's understand what is the question asked. Correct? So what are they saying in the question? They are saying there is a company which is a public limited company. Correct? So they have not talked about listing. So it is an unlisted company because they have given that criteria of appointing minimum 2 independent directors comes in. So it cannot be a listed company. 14 directors are there. Maximum 15 can be there. They want to appoint 4 more directors because as per law, they have to appoint minimum 2. So they say we want to appoint 4 more. So they are appointing 4 additional directors over here. Now these 4 additional directors, independent directors, they are appointing. Understood? So section 149 is attracted. Correct? They removed 4 directors from the company and they appointed 4 other directors in the company, which are rotational directors. As they said, all the directors are rotational only in their company. Correct? So they removed few and they appointed few. So apparently, how did they appoint is the question. Correct. So the answer is what? How did they appoint? They appointed by passing a single resolution, which is the provision of section 162, if you remember. Am I right, everybody? Clear? This much is clear? Understood. So this basic concepts, if you can understand, understood. These basic concepts, if you can understand, things will be very, very, really easy for all of us. Am I right? Okay. Then let's see what is the multiple choice question. In the above scenario, A, B, C, D were appointed as the directors by passing a single resolution. Is that appointment valid? Absolutely, yes. Obviously, that appointment is valid. How is it valid? Let's see, 4 options are there. The appointment of A, B, C, D by a single resolution is valid because beforehand, before passing that single resolution, a motion authorizing their appointment by single resolution was passed in the meeting and not a single vote was casted against them. Meaning what? 100% votes were in favor. Am I right? Clear, everybody? So apparently for me, this first option itself looks very good. Yes or no? Let's see. Let's see the other options. Correct? The appointment of A, B, C, D by single resolution is not valid because passing a resolution by simple majority indicates it was not passed unanimously. Passing by single majority does not indicate it was not passed unanimously. So anyways, we don't have to pass any resolution for appointment of director unanimously. It is either ordinary or special. Appointment of A, B, C, D by single resolution is not valid because such a resolution is required to be passed by special resolution. Who said? You are removing some directors. You are appointing some another director. Why do you need special resolution? Is for reappointment of the same directors. Yes or no? So apparently this is also wrong. Correct? And then you have appointment of A, B, C, D by single resolution is not valid because no case more than one directors can be appointed by. Who said? Section 162 clearly says that you can appoint by a single resolution. Yes. So according to me, my answer should be this. Yes, my answer should be point number A. So for the first multiple choice question, my answer is A point. All right, let's see whether we are right or wrong. Multiple choice question, integrated answer, first one, A. So yes, we are absolutely correct. Correct, everybody? Understood? Sure? Perfect. Okay. So this was just, I wanted to show you how we are going to do this particular concepts. Okay. So I'll take this again and we go to the next question. In the given case, according to the articles, all the directors are rotational. Correct. So they have clearly given all are rotational. Had these not been the case, how many directors were required to retire at the AGM, which was held on 20th August 2018? So they are talking about an AGM held on 20th August 2018, meaning that four independent directors were not there. Correct? Previous year. Okay. So how many directors were there in the company? I'll write it over here. Okay. Sir, 14 were there. Okay. So let's take the calculator over here now. 14 were there. And what are they saying? 14 were there. All are rotational directors. So I have to divide straight away 14 into 1 by 3 only, because when all are rotational, it is 2/3 already. But if you read the question very clearly, all the directors are rotational. But had this not been the case, they are saying. Meaning, what if they were non-rotational? Well, if they were non-rotational, I would do 14 into 2 by 3. Correct? Which comes to how much? 14 into 2 by 3 comes to 9.33. Yes. So when I say it is 9.33 over here, we have to round it off always to next number. Yes or no? We will always round this up to the next number. I have given you the explanation also and concept also in our class. Okay. So it is already given in our notes also, everything. Correct? Okay. So now 10 is there. So sir, 10 will... No, no, not 10. So now we have to take 10 and go to 1 by 3, which comes to 10 into 1 divided by 3.33. And here we will take the nearest number to 3.33, which is none other than 3. Correct? Let's see. Is 3 there in the options given to us? 5 directors? No. 4 directors? No. 3 directors? Yes. And one more is there option. 2 directors? No. So for question number 2, my answer is C. Let's see whether my answer is correct or incorrect. Question number 2, it is C. Everybody following the point? Yes, everyone? Correct. Now, let's go to the next one. Third question. Third question says, in the given case scenario, if it is presumed that on 31st March 2019, the turnover of the company was 87 crores. Actually, it crossed 100 crores. But if it is assumed that it was 87 crores, paid-up share capital was 12 crores. Paid up share capital is 12 crores, meaning more than 10 crores. Does not matter. It is either turnover or paid up share capital or outstanding. Correct. 10 crores, 100 crores, 50 crores. Any one condition should be satisfied. You agree? Correct. So here they are saying, let's see if something like that, if it, this is 12 crores and this is 87 crores, would the company still mandatorily be required to appoint two independent directors? Obviously, the answer has to be yes. I mean, here you should not take a single minute over to think, correct? But still, right now we are discussing. So let's figure out. There is no need to appoint two independent directors since aggregate turnover and paid up share capital. Condition is never and over here. Instead of appointing two independent directors, company is required to appoint only one independent director since aggregate of turnover and paid up share capital and paid up share capital. The company is required to appoint minimum two independent directors since paid up share capital is 12 crore. Okay, this one looks good to me for now. Let's see, one more option is there. The company is required to appoint only one independent director. There is no concept of one independent director. Yes or no? So there is no such concept. Absolutely. So the third answer that I have got is C. Again, let's check it out whether it is C or not. Third answer. Uh-oh, I'll take it. Correct answer, green color. Yes, third answer is C. Perfect. So let's do it. Let's go next. According to the case scenario, the company altered its articles. Yes. So as to increase the total strength of directors up to 20 from the present 15. Correct. Which of the following option is applicable in such case of alteration? Which option is applicable in such case of alteration? First option. First option is, the articles were altered by passing ordinary resolution. Okay. Can you alter the articles by passing ordinary resolution? That is our first question. No idea, sir. See, this is where little bit of basics are required. Yeah. Little bit of basics are required because this is a CA inter question. Alteration of MOA, alteration of KOA. Correct. So, anyway, we will do it. This is wrong. Oh, red color I will take. The articles were altered by passing an ordinary resolution followed by a approval of jurisdictional ROC. There is no concept like that. The articles were altered by passing a board resolution with more than 75% majority. There is never 75% majority taken in board of directors. Okay. There is either 51% or 100%. Clear, everybody? So I'm left with anyway only one option. The articles were altered by passing a special resolution. Perfect. This is what I was waiting for. So for 4, my answer is D. Let's check. 4, it is D. So yes, we are safe so far. Let's go to the next one. 5th one. As on 12th of August 2019, when the AGM of the company was held, the total strength of directors reached 18 due to appointment of 4 independent directors. Yes, we are already aware. We know that, sir. When all the directors are rotational, how many shall get retired at the AGM? When all the directors are rotational, then how many shall get retired? Well, now for this, we will need a calculator, naturally. Correct? So, the answer. Before we find out the answer, let's calculate. So we have, I'll write it over here only again. 18 are there. This is the total strength minus the independent directors. Correct. So you have 14 left. Out of 14, we will take 2/3. But no, what they have said, when all the directors are rotational, meaning this all 14 are rotational. So what you will do? Directly take 1/3. Correct. So 14 into 1 divided by 3 comes to 4.66, which is nearest number to 5. Is 5 there in the option? Yes, my 5 is there in the option. So for the 5th point, B is my answer. B for Bombay. Correct. So let's see. 5. Perfect. It is Everybody clear with this? Yes. So with this, we have solved our first integrated case study. I hope you understood, and I hope you understood how to do it. Correct? So case studies are going to be many, which will come in your exams, but how to solve them is important. Correct? Fine. So if you are done with this, let's go to the next one. Okay. If you are not done with this, I am going to the next one. You can just pause over there. Yes. Download your RTP. If you have already downloaded, perfect. Go through it, solve it. For doubts, rewind back, see the video again, and let's go to the next one. So Alibaba Limited is a listed company. Perfect. So no confusion over here. Listed company. Which company? Alibaba Limited is a listed company. Okay. It's having its registered office in Andhra Pradesh. Fair enough. Mrs. Smart is a managing director of Alibaba Limited. Since its incorporation, she was the first director and one of the promoters of the company. Fine. Good, Mrs. Smart. She has a vast experience in managing the company. Ah, very good. Time pass. Alibaba Limited is a holding of PM Limited. Yes. Now, this is something important. With a Fira Private Limited as a subsidiary to PM Limited. So apparently what is there? There is this Alibaba Limited having subsidiary PM Limited having subsidiary Fira Private Limited. Understood? Okay. So now things which you have to mark. Okay. This is a listed company. Nothing specified for PM Limited. So it is an unlisted company. As of now, it is an unlisted company. If they give it as listed, we will change it. And this is a private company. So we have all the three varieties in a single question. Correct? This is where the game begins. Understand very properly now. What is the case over here? Following are the details pertaining to the incorporation of the related entities and its capital structure. Okay. So we have Alibaba, we have PM, and we have Fira. Date of incorporation is given. Fine. Information only. Place of registered office. All is in India. 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 Fine. So information only. Authorized share capital, useless for us. We don't see it anywhere. Paid up share capital. This is like very, very important. Correct. How much is the paid up share capital? It is 99 crores. Anyways, it is a listed company. I don't care. Correct. Here. Unit 10, 100, 1000, 10,000 lakh, 10 lakh crore, 10 crore. Sir, unlisted company greater than or equal to 10 crores. Independent director, etc. conditions will be attracted. So let's highlight this point. Correct. After that, Fira Private Limited conditions are anyways not applicable. So I don't care about its paid up share capital. So this one was very, very important for me. Understood. This one was very, very important for me. If this was less than 10 crores, conditions may not have been attracted. Anyway, under the guidance of Mrs. Smart, Alibaba Limited acquired the shareholding in PM Limited and thus resulting into a subsidiary company of Alibaba Limited. Fine. Now the board of directors of Alibaba Limited wishes to nominate Mrs. Smart for the position of managing director in PM Limited also. So in holding, she is a MD. In subsidiary also, they want to appoint her same person, that is her as the MD. And also appoint her as a whole-time director in Fira Private Limited, a private limited company that is a subsidiary of the subsidiary. They want to appoint her as a whole-time director over there. Subsidiary of the subsidiary. Which one? It is a whole time subsidiary. Remember, they have given it is a whole time subsidiary. Sorry, wholly owned a subsidiary. Yeah, 100% owned it. Therefore, the board of directors of PM Limited passed a board resolution Okay, board of directors passed a board resolution through circulation. Through circulation. Now, first question that has to come to your mind, sir, can we pass board resolution through circulation? Is it allowed? Is it possible? I will say, before I tell you the answer, I will say, refer section 175, which talks about resolution by circulation. If you are my student, you dare not forget this concept. We have done this in the handwritten notes of the class also, the summary notes which I have given to you. Okay, and it is there in the main book also. To appoint Mrs. Smart as the managing director of the company, fair enough. Subsequently, the board of directors of Fira Private Limited passed the board resolution. Okay, so in Fira Private Limited also, board resolution was passed. PM Limited also, board resolution was passed. Wherein all the directors present in the meeting approved the resolution for appointing her as the whole-time director of the company. And subsequently, a unanimous board approval, Fira Private Limited also conducted a general meeting for getting the approval of the shareholders. What? Fira Private Limited conducted a general meeting. So practically, if I assume, when I'm talking about a private limited company, private means public is not there. Directors, most of the time, themselves are the shareholders only. Anyways, let's see further. And passed an ordinary resolution in the general meeting. Wow, very good. So apparently what they have done, they have appointed a director by board resolution, but they have ratified that appointment by passing a general ordinary resolution in the general meeting again. Very systematic, I will say, for Fira Private Limited. But I have my concerns for PM Limited. Why? Because they called a board meeting, they passed resolution and finish. And finish. Correct. So anyways, let's see further. Further, for the appointment of Mrs. Smart, PM Limited and Fira Private Limited had complied with Schedule 5 of Companies Act 2013. For those who did not understand, refer section 197 from my book. Yes, 197, managerial remuneration. Company is having losses or inadequate profit. That is when they refer the Schedule 5. Otherwise, you will never refer Schedule 5. All right? As a result, respective companies did not take any approval from the central government for her appointment as managing director and all-time director respectively. So they have not taken approval of central government. First thing you should think, sir, do we need to take approval of central government in such cases? Yes or no? Understood. So for that purpose, whether you need to take approval of a central government or not, you need to refer section 196 also, appointment of MD, WTD or manager. Correct? Based on the above provided information and in the light of the applicable provisions read with Schedule 5 of the Act, you are asked to advise on the following multiple choice questions. Fine. You ask, we will answer. Let's see. Before, I am strongly recommending you, before you solve this, you can simply pause the video and go through the sections from whatever author's book you are referring, guys. Whatever author, every author is the best. Everybody wants you to pass. Okay, so everybody is the best. Refer anybody. I would personally suggest don't refer institute material over here. Okay, if you are referring institute material, keep your RTP handy. Okay, keep your RTP handy because amendments are there. They may not be there in the latest material of the institute which you might be referring to. So if you are updated with the institute material, yes, institute material, obviously it has to be good only. But in case you are referring to a little bit older, one attempt old version also, guys, this is law. Every attempt, there are going to be amendments and everything changes. So you have to be very, very smart. Am I right or am I right? Yes. So now let's begin. Read those sections which I have marked and then solve this. State on the validity of appointment of Mrs. Smart as the managing director of PM Limited. So they are only asking for this public company. Okay. In terms of the provisions of Companies Act 2013. First option says it is invalid. as no such appointment was made or approved by the resolution passed at board meeting with the consent of all the directors present at the meeting and supported by general meeting's ordinary. I told you immediately when we read the question, I told you Fira Private Limited, what they did sounds systematic. They called for a board meeting, asked every director, passed the resolution for her appointment. When all the board of directors agreed, it was ratified in the general meeting, section 196. Correct? So this option looks good to me for now. I will just tick it for now. Maybe we will change it afterwards. Valid as a whole time KMP shall hold office. Shall hold office? Is it compulsory? Not at all. Who says it is compulsory? Valid with further approval of CG. If you read 196, 197, CG approval is no longer required anywhere. Correct? Invalid because a person cannot hold more than one office as a managing director. Is that so? I would say refer section 203, appointment of KMP. Yes, if you are a managing director, you can still hold more than one offices with exceptions. Refer section 203, everybody. Correct? Fine. So, well, here for the first one, A looks good. Let's see. We are talking about the second integrated case studies and we are talking about the first one and answer is A. So, till now we are going smooth. Yeah? Okay. Let's go to the next one. Whether Mrs. Smart's appointment as a whole-time director in Fira Private Limited is valid? Yes or no? I told you, Fira Private Limited, what we said, sounds good, sounds perfect, normal. Yes? So no, because being private limited company, Rule 8A of Companies Act is not applicable. Yeah, fine, not applicable. So what? We are not concerned only about Rule 8 or 8A. We are only talking about procedure. Correct? So I will ignore this for now. I'll keep it on ignore mode. Yes, as per Section 271, it is a deemed public company. This one looks, sounds very, 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 very important. Sir, why? Because what is a public company? A public company is a company which is not a private company. Yes? A public company is a company which accepts public deposits. Yes? So then, sir, what is a private company? A private company is a company which is registered as a private company. Absolutely correct. Yes, sir. So now, what are we thinking about? Why are we wasting time here? Sir, a holding company is a public company and subsidiary is a private company. Then subsidiary will be considered as a private company only. Obviously, it will be considered as a private company only, but compliance purpose, it will be deemed to be a public company. Again, CA Inter. All CA Inter concepts, your basics have to be clear. That is what we try to clear in the class. Correct? This is what we try to clear in our class. If your basics are clear, then your success is very, 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 very near. Yes, my dear. Right? Anyways, let's see further options also. Let's not be very sure with the B option right now. Yes, on the further approval of central government. No, man. CG approvals are not required anymore anyway. No. Because restriction under 2033, there is a restriction they are saying on appointment in more than one company. 2033 gives exception that you can be appointed. No. So, well, this looks the rightest option over here. Correct? For two, it looks like B, but wait. That's all the third one also. Then we will go to find together. What will be the legal position as to the appointment of Mrs. Smart as the managing director of PM Limited if Alibaba is a government company? If Alibaba, your whole answer, your whole life will change. Whenever we have written in our summary notes in the class also, after every particular section, I have specifically given it to you that this section is applicable to private company or government company or subsidiary of government company or not. So if you have revised it properly, then this will be smooth. Otherwise, even God can bless you. Revise the section well and then answer this question. What if it was a government company? Then invalid due to non-compliance of 203. Why what is non-compliance in 203? Why? How did they not comply 203? I feel 203 has been complied. Why? provisions of 203 have been complied. Why? How can you say provisions of 203 have been complied? Sir, very simple. In 203, appointment of KMP, all these concepts are covered with the exceptions to government company. Yes? So this is wrong. I'll change the color. Valid in the light of 2034A. Valid? Even I feel it is valid only. So appointment is valid. If it is a government company, provisions are anyways not applicable. So appointment will be valid. Valid with the approval of CG. Why they are putting CG? CG approvals are not required anywhere over here now. This is only for confusing you. Invalid because one person cannot hold office. Who said it cannot hold office? One person can definitely hold office. Read 203 properly. So we are left with only one option. B. Anyways, our answer for second question also is B. And third question also is B only. Did we do a mistake? I don't think so. As I said, B. Yes, perfect. So now let's go to the next question. What is the status of FIRA Private Limited for the purpose of applicability of Companies Act if Alibaba Limited is a government company? If Alibaba Limited holding is a government company, then its subsidiary or its subsidiary is a subsidiary will also always be treated like a government company only. It will be deemed a government company always. Yes. So for fourth one, I don't even have to check any other option. It is C only, outright correct answer. Okay guys, so let's go to question number 5. Okay. Where the appointment of Mrs. Smart, who is the whole time as a whole time director, they are saying in FIRA Private Limited. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to appoint her as a whole time director in FIRA Private Limited. Whether it can be legally acceptable, provided Alibaba is a government company. Now here, all your answers change. Yes, everywhere where your normal answer is yes. If I say if it is a government company, if it is a private company, if it is a one person company, all your answers change. Correct? So you have to very, very carefully answer these questions. For my students, guys, everything is specifically noted and written in our handbook also. Summary notes, that is. Correct? In our handbook also and in main book, obviously everything is there. Correct? So in case you have missed out on that lecture or you were absent, make sure you are updated. And for others who are not my students but watching the video, and if you think that it is helpful to you and you need, you let me know that you need the summary book. Okay, I will make sure that the summary book reaches you anyhow. Okay, right now we have all faced a lot of issues with respect to courier services and everything also. So main book, I had distributed free of cost soft copies all over India to anyone and everyone who needs it. Okay, so if you also need and you have not received it yet, the main book, you let me know. I will make sure I personally WhatsApp or email you the soft copy of the main book. Understood? All that we need over here and everywhere is you to become a chartered accountant. Correct? So yes, I will do that. Summary book, soft copies, I may not be able to share for some reasons, whatever reasons, anyways. So anyways, hard copy, I will definitely make sure you get it courier to your address. All right, fine. So now let's go to the answers. If it is a government company, if Alibaba is a government company, that is the main holding company is a government company. In that case, can she become a whole-time director in a subsidiary of a subsidiary, which is a private company? Let's see. First is no, because FIRA Private Limited is a private company. So rule 8 and 8A of the company's rules is not applicable. I cannot say that it is not applicable. Why, sir? See, the logic and reason is very simple. Because if you are talking about FIRA Private Limited, who is a subsidiary of a holding company, which is a government company, then we already said this will be deemed to be like a government company only. So most of all the provisions of government company are going to be applicable to them. Correct? So because it is private company, no, I don't agree. Yes, because section 203 is not applicable to government company. This is the easiest, I guess, we can get. Yes. Section 203 is not applicable to government company. We have written it in 203 also, if you remember, if you can check. Correct? Yes, further approval. You don't need approval of central government anymore. Why are they giving options for central government? Because earlier it was required. Then it got amended. To make sure that you are updated with the amendments or not, this is the point that they are using to confuse you. All right. So last one. No, because the restriction under 2033. What is the restriction under 2033? That you cannot become a full-time director in any other company. But for the restriction, again, there is an exception also over there. Correct. So again, this one also is wrong. So according to me, the fifth point, the answer should be B. Let's check it out. B, 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 B. Yes, and we are correct. The answer is B. Right? Okay, fair enough. Let's go to the next ones without cheating. Okay, now, new question. Third question. In case of Topeka Sugar Mills Limited, necessary arrangements are in the place for conducting of board meetings through means of video conferencing. Okay, let me highlight. Topeka Sugar Mills Limited. So again, it is not a private company. Necessary arrangements are there for conducting board meeting by video conferencing. So board meetings by video conferencing. Can you hold board meetings by video conferencing? Yes, sir. Who said that? Refer section 173, everybody. A facility which Vaibhav and Yukta, two directors out of the six, intend to utilize to participate by video conferencing. Okay. So there are two people. One is Vaibhav and one is Yukta. Two directors out of the six directors want to participate through video conference. Fair enough. Okay. During which part of the year they should intimate the company about their participation in the board meeting through video conference? Seriously, is that a question? During which part of the year they should? This is like the easiest. If you are holding the notes in your hand, my notes in your hand, open the summary notes. Open the summary notes where amendments we have highlighted. If you are not holding the summary notes, my notes in your hand, in that case, any other author you are holding, go directly to the amendment. And if at all you don't have any particular book, on YouTube itself, I have uploaded RTP amendment lecture. Yes, RTP amendment lectures are also there. Directly refer to the amendment notes which are attached. You will find at the beginning of the financial year, I don't think so. On the first day of the month falling in the financial year, no. Before the board meeting, no. At the beginning of the calendar year, it is an amendment and it is clearly written in your notes. So here, I don't even want to check the answer. This is like the easiest one. Yes or no? Okay, let's go to the next one. We'll check the answers afterwards. Blue Rose Agri Products Limited. Again, I'm marking limited. Which is inter alia listed. Okay, so this is a listed public company. Called Extraordinary General Meeting of the Shareholders on 29th January. Okay. So they have called an Extraordinary General Meeting. Can a listed company call for an Extraordinary General Meeting? Answer is absolutely yes. Sir, who said? Who said? CI Inter said. Section 96, 97, 98, 99 and 100. Understood? They are the beginning sections of the chapter of General Meetings. Okay. Anyways. At its head office in New Delhi to seek approval for certain matters. Fine. It so happened that the company received a notice on 25th of January. Wait. Let's see the dates. Called Extraordinary General Meeting on 29th. Company received notice on 25th from requisite number of small shareholders. Requisite number of small shareholders. Sir, what is requisite number of small shareholders? It is 1/10 or 1,000 small shareholder, whichever is less. Sir, who said? Who said? Who said? Nobody said. Section 151 said. Yes, go to section 151 straight away in your notes and verify. who proposed the appointment of Shivank as the director, but it refused to entertain the notice as the same was served quite late. Makes sense, yes or no? How do you know makes sense? If you remember the procedure that we have done for section 151, 10 points we have done, correct? First one, who can give application? Second one, minimum requisition. If minimum requisition is received, then with that minimum requisition, will you go into the meeting and start shouting, we want SSD, we want SSD, we want SSD? No, you will not do that, correct? So systematically, you will intimate the company 14 days in advance. Yes or no? So here 29th, 25th, only 4 days are there. So what they are saying, but it refused to entertain as the notice was received quite late. Fine. Advice, the latest date by which the small shareholders must give the notice, 14 days before the meeting. So if the meeting is on 29th of January, I want to go 14 days behind this date. 14 days behind this date means somewhere around 14th or 15th. 15th? Do we have 15th? Yes. 15th of January. Yes. If you have the procedures in your hand, go to the third point. It is clearly written 14 days notice is required. So, shall we check other answers? We need not. Let's go to the next one. The IRP, Interim Resolution Professional. Okay, remember IRP, Interim Resolution Professional. IRP, appointed for M Limited, is seeking your views. Give them your views. On the constitution of the COC of M Limited. Fair enough. So there is an IRP who wants your views because you are a professional. Okay. So he wants to make a, committee of creditors in M Limited. Okay. M Limited does not have financial debt. Super. Other than a loan. Okay. So one financial debt is there. Correct. Committee of creditors means? Committee of creditors means group of all financial creditors taken together. Okay, that is what committee of creditors. Are we okay with that? Yes. So company does not have financial debt. Fair enough. So if there is no financial debt, then what do? Then we take top 18 operational creditors and one representative of the workmen and employee each. Correct? Let's see. But here they are having, I guess, they are having other than one loan. Yes. So one loan is there. Obtained from Mr. A. Who is the son of Mr. B? Who is Mr. B? The managing director of M. M Limited. Who is under the IBC proceedings? Okay. This M Limited, whose IBC proceedings are going on, the managing director of this company has given a loan to the company. Can he be considered as a financial creditor or not? Or shall he be considered as a relative and excluded from the list? Let's see. Let's read the question. Identify the appropriate constitution of the committee of creditors out of the following. Fine. So, Mr. A, who is the son of Mr. B? Who is Mr. B? Sir, Mr. B is the managing director in this case. Managing director of the company, which is under insolvency bankruptcy. Understood? So, his son is there. Son is there, so definitely he's a relative. And if I am considering relatives, then if you see the insolvency bankruptcy code notes, which we have provided, correct? Over there, we have clearly written that relatives are not to be included over here. So A cannot be included in financial creditors. So technically, if A is not there, there are no financial creditors. And if no financial creditors are there, then what will be the answer? 18. Plus one, plus one. Correct? So let's see. First option is Mr. A. 18 largest operational creditors and one representative. Mr. A, they have given. So this is wrong. 18, 1. This looks good. I'll keep this first aside. Mr. A, since he is the only financial creditor, but he is also the relative. So 18, one representative of resolution professional and resolution professional employees representative, workmen representative. Why resolution professional will go into the committee of creditors? Absolutely. This is This is not even wrong. This is the wrongest answer. Yes or no? All right. So one option left, that is B. Correct? Hey, is there a sequence thing over here we are doing? Question number 3, answer is B. 4, answer is B. 5, answer is B. So we have done 3 questions over here, okay, which are not a part of integrated case study. They are simple case law, simple MCQs, and all the 3 answers are B only. Super, lovely. Let's see next one. Which of the following terms are not included within the arrangements entered into by the central government with another country in relation to reciprocal arrangements under Prevention of Money Laundering Act 2002? Okay. Now here, I think you may not be aware. I think so. Concept may be there in our main book, but this concept will not be there in our summary book. Okay. So which of the following terms are not included within the arrangements entered into by the central government with another country? Okay. So our central government, another country, which of the following is not included in the arrangement? Enforcement of the provisions of PMLA, that is definitely there. That is definitely going to be there. Correct? So this is going to be there. Shall I tick it? When I'm ticking this, this is not the answer, but this answer is correct. We have to find which one is not there. Okay, negative answer. Prevention of offense in India under the corresponding PMLA law in force in other country. First and second option is same only. Enforcement of provisions of PMLA, how will you enforce it to a person over there? Corresponding law in that country. Exchange the history of the person if it is useful, if it is a willful offender under PMLA on annual basis. On annual basis, every year I will give details about no. This answer, we have our doubts. Correct? And D? What is D? Exchange information to prevent any offense under PMLA. This we can, okay. Exchange information we can do to prevent any offense in PMLA. Okay. So these 3 things we are doing, but they are asking not included. Not included, I don't think exchanging information on annual basis is a part of any agreement. Correct? So our answer over here is going to be C. Oh, finally. It's C and not B again, right? Okay, let's see if it is right or wrong afterwards. Next one. So the next one is Mr. V, brother of Mr. R, is a resident of Singapore. Wow. And he owns an immovable property in Chennai. Wow. Which he inherited from his father, okay, who was a resident of India. Fine. Can Mr. V continue to hold his property? It is his property. Why can't he continue to hold his property? I mean, he inherited it from his father. His father left it behind. Correct? And if he inherited it, who are we to take it away from him? Correct? Let's see. No, he cannot hold the transfer or invest in India since he is a resident outside India. Nonsense. His father gave it to him. He is not investing it. Yes, he can continue to hold in India since he is a person of India origin and the property is located in India. Okay, this answer we can consider. Yes, he can continue to hold the property since this was inherited from a person who was a resident in India. Yes, this is more satisfactory. Correct? Yes, he can continue to hold the property since his brother, Mr. R, uses the property whenever he travels to Chennai. No. Brother uses or does not use, that is none of our concern. Whenever he comes to Chennai, our government is not going to follow him to see where is he going to stay. Understood? So that does not make sense. So we have got 2 options over here. 2 options are there and we have to select the best of them if we are not very sure about the perfect one. Correct? So, I feel he has inherited it from the father, from his father, correct? And because of which, he shall be eligible to hold it. So, my answer will be C. What is yours? Tick and keep. We will verify after this last particular answer. Okay. Which among the following is legally acceptable, permissible source for funding overseas direct investment ODI, overseas direct investment, if you want to borrow, then which is the most permitted source? There is only one, external commercial borrowing, which we have read about. ECB. First answer only, I think. Real estate, banking, foreign currency funds raised through other than ADR, GDR. You cannot raise only like that. Correct? This is also wrong. This is also wrong. This is also wrong. Sir, how is it so easy? Guys, these questions are going to be very easy. You know why? This is amendment. Straight direct questions from the amendments. Direct questions. Even conceptually, they are not trying to confuse you. Imagine, these are amendments. I have always said amendments are super important. And why is it super important? You can see in front of your eyes. Correct? So answer is A. Let's verify. First three answers were B, right? After that, C. C. And A. Let's see what are the answers. B, 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 C, C, A is our answers. Oh, B, 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 C, C, A. Fantastic. Yes, fantastic. That was, and with this, we have successfully finished the MCQs. Correct? So see, here what happened was, I was reading the MCQs for you. I was explaining the MCQs to you. And then we were marking the answers. And then we were checking the answers. So as you can see, naturally, it took us a lot of time. Almost an hour has passed, right? But when you do it for your exams or in your exams, you won't be taking so much of time. You won't have so much of time. Why I'm doing it? Why I'm marking sections over there? To just make you understand that every section over here is important. They can ask you anything from anywhere. Correct? So make sure your concepts are clear. Alright? Everyone. Fine. Now let's go to the descriptive questions. Okay. Before we go to the descriptive questions, okay, I would like you to just go through these particular MCQs, after which we will jump on to the descriptive ones. Alright? Do it now. So now let's go to the descriptive questions, correct? So yes, the descriptive question number one. Okay, so this is descriptive question number one. Actually, it is question number 9. Total, there are 20 questions. All right, so around 11 to 12 questions are there, which we have to study, understand, and clear our concepts. Let's do it. As you can see on your screen, Aster Limited, a listed company, deals in a business. Now, Aster Limited is a company that deals in a business of trading with raw materials. Correct. Now, this is a company which is trading in raw materials. You said, okay, I don't care what they're trading. Correct. So, what is the points that we should care about when we read the question? To understand that, I have done the highlighting part already over there. When you read Aster Limited, a listed company, first I will highlight listed company because that is very important for us to determine whether all the conditions, provisions are applicable or not. Correct. So that is the first thing that we need to see. After that, the next thing that we need to check is company was running in losses. Now, if they are saying the company was running in losses for the past 2 years, meaning company did not have the profits, so maybe no dividend paid, maybe no money to pay the remuneration also. Correct? So these are some issues that the company has been facing. Fine, let us see. Then they are saying company, the board of directors appointed Mr. C as a whole-time director. He was 70 years old on the day of his appointment. Okay. He was 70 years old when he was appointed. Fair enough. Following are the relevant extracts from the audited financial statements as on 31st March 2019. What are they saying? Authorized share capital of the company is given. Useless for us. Does not matter. If you are doing accounts, subject, sum, then maybe it is important. In law, it is of no use practically. Correct? So that is useless for us. Then they are saying paid up capital was 215 crores. That is important for us. Company was in the process of FPO. Okay. Hence, had the balance of 15 crores in share application money account. Fair enough. Just information part for us. Okay. Let's see. I've written many things over there. Don't read anything right now. Let us just go through the question once. The balance of the reserves and surplus was 170 crores, of which 150 was general reserve, 20 was revaluation reserve. Okay, fair, noted. Long-term loan, 200 crores. Okay, noted. investments 40 crores and accumulated losses 10 crores. Fine. So whatever they have said, we have noted, we have taken a point. And now let's go to the next part. In the light of the given facts and figures, evaluate the situations in terms of Companies Act 2013 related provisions. Okay, three questions are there and we have to answer the three questions. What is it? Validity of Mr. C as a managerial person in the office of whole-time director. Now, validity means we have to see managing director validity, section 196. Okay, so we will write over here. Section 196. Compute the effective capital of Aster Limited for the payment of managerial remuneration. Okay, so effective capital means companies in losses. So effective capital, because you cannot give any percentage of profits, correct? So you have to check Schedule 5, Section 197. Understood. Section 197 talks about managerial remunerations. And in 197, we have Schedule 5, which shows you the table for effective capital. Clear? Since Aster Limited was running in losses, state the maximum amount of the remuneration which is to be paid on yearly basis. Fine. So this is just a state the maximum amount which you can pay. So practically last we read, as per the provisions, you can pay how much? You can pay any amount. There is no limit as such, right? So in Schedule 5, effective capital table, there is a limit. And if you want to pay more than that, you can definitely pass the resolution and increase your limit and pay any amount that you want to pay. Correct? So practically, there is no limit at all. Fine. Anyways, let's analyze the question now for doing the answers. So they have given you this data to find out the effective capital. Okay, so when you have this particular data to find out the effective capital, let us analyze the data. What they have given, what is effective capital first of all? Schedule 5, those who have notes, open the main book, I have given the table. Those who are referring any other notes, open any of your books, effective capital will be there everywhere. Those who don't have any notes, Google effective capital table Schedule 5, you will get it. Okay. Let us see the mathematically how much is the effective capital. They are saying paid up share capital 215 crores. So share capital plus reserves and surplus plus long term liabilities. Yes. Minus your investments. Minus your accumulated losses. Correct. Accumulated losses, preliminary expenses, all that we never include. P&L debit balance and all. So we will reduce. So fine. So first, what are we going to do? We have 200 and I'll write it over here. Okay. 215 is there. 215. Hence had a balance of 15 crores in application money account. What is this application money account? So, okay. Out of the 215, which is the total paid up capital, they have two bifurcations. 200 crores is your amount of the capital. Correct. 200 crores is the amount of the capital and that 15 crores is for the FPO, which is going to come, which has not yet come. So you cannot include that funds in your share capital definitely. So what we will do is reduce 15 from here. Correct? Comes to 200. Right? Next is what? Next is reserves and surplus 170 crores. So okay, 170. Correct? General reserve is 150. Revaluation reserve. Revaluation reserve is not available in cash. Correct? So subtract, you get 150. We will add outstanding loan amount 200 crores. So add 200 crores. Company had investments of 40 crores. Investment 40 crores. So 40 less. And then what they are saying? Accumulated losses. Okay. That also less. What is the total? 200, 400, 500. 550 minus 50 comes to 500. My effective capital is 500. Correct? So that is easy to understand. Now what we have to do is first check whether our effective capital calculation is correct or not. Second, if this is the effective capital, then how much remuneration can you pay on this much effective capital? Okay, so let's go to the answer. Descriptive question, first one. Section 196.3, I told you we have marked section 196, whether the appointment is valid or not, we have to check first. So what is 196 say? 196 say appointment of MD, WTD or manager, correct? You can appoint any person as an MD, WTD or manager. Who will appoint? Board of directors will appoint, correct? The board of directors will appoint any person as an MD, WTD or manager. Minimum age is 21 years, we have written over there. Maximum age is 70 years, again, that also we have written over there. So all these points are there in our summary notes. I could show you, then I will show you. Yeah. Okay. Here you are. See, this is section 196 on your screen, correct? What does 196 say? Term of appointment is given, qualification. Yes, qualification 21 to 70 years, maximum 70, ordinary resolution. After that, you need special resolution with explanatory statement. Whenever you need special resolution, that is at and after 70 years, maximum it is up to 70. Once you touch 70, you need special resolution, correct? So that note also we have given here, amendment part, correct? So if special resolution is required to be passed, but when I'm passing the special resolution, okay, pay attention. When I'm passing the special resolution, what is happening? I am passing it, but I'm not getting 75% votes. But I still want to appoint that same person as the MD, WTD or manager. Then what should we do? In that case, when you are passing, but you are still not getting 75%, what they are saying? If the number of votes in favor exceed the number of votes against, read the note carefully, correct? In that case, you can appoint such person. Yes or no? So, perfect. That is our case anyways, correct? He's 70 years old and they have passed the resolution. So, let's see the facts of our answer. Yes. No company shall appoint or continue the employment of any person as an MD, WTD or manager who is below the age of 21 years. And maximum age of 70 years, unless that appointment of a person who has attained the age of 70 years may be made by passing special resolution. Same point, exact wordings that which we have used, correct? With an explanatory statement, that also we said. Now, where no such special resolution is passed, but votes cast in favor exceed the votes cast against, remember that note point in black color, correct? The motion and the central government is satisfied on the application made by the board that such appointment is the most beneficial to the company, you can maybe made, you can appoint such person. So practically I want to appoint a person who is 70 years or more, but before I appoint such person, I want to make sure that can you appoint a person who is more than 70 years old? Law says you can definitely appoint, but you need special resolution. And if at all special resolution is passed, but you don't get 75% approval, but more than 51 is there, but less than 75 is there. So who said more than 51? It is written votes cast in favor are more than the votes cast against, correct? So more means what? It has to be more than 50%, correct? So it is 51% or more anyways, but not up to 75. But you want to appoint that person, take CG approval, correct? So here, this is a point which has been added. Take CG approval and then you can appoint such person. So there we have answered our first question. Second was effective capital. This is the theory of effective capital on your screen, correct? Let's go to the table. Our answer was 500 if you remember, correct? So answer is same, which means that we are on the right track. Yes. How we came to 500, why added, why deleted? I have already explained. Anyways, whatever I already explained, it is also written here in the theory part. Okay, so you can simply refer. Next, the question is how much remuneration can be paid, and if I want to pay more, then can we pay more? Is there an option? Let's see. So as per schedule 5, what they are saying, if you have effective capital 500 crores, then how much can you pay? Here it says, if effective capital of the company is 250 crores or more, our is more only, then yearly remuneration per person shall not exceed 120 lakhs, that is fixed, plus 0.01% of the effective capital in excess of 250 crores. Correct. So let's see, maximum remuneration that may be paid to each managerial person will be how much? 120 lakhs plus 0.01% of 250 crores, which comes to 2.25. So your total is 122.5 lakhs. Understood. Total is 122.5 lakhs. So this is the maximum annual managerial remuneration that you can pay per manager. Clear, everybody? Yes or no? Sure? Yes? All right. Then they had asked you one more question. If you want to pay more than the given limit in Schedule 5. So what they say? Excess of the above limits may be paid. Special resolution is required. Understood? So focus on the highlighted parts. Revision test paper has to be revised, not learned. This has to go very, very fast. Okay, next question comes. That is question number 10. Let's read the question first. Questions. And here we are. Question number 10. In front of us. Fame Limited filed an application to registrar for the removal of name. Okay, so company is filing an application for the removal of name of the company from the register of ROC. Guys, before you read this particular question, I would urge you kindly read section 248 to section 252 of the Companies Act 2013. Yes, for those who are referring my book, it is already there in the summary book also, and it is totally, totally updated and amended. Okay, yeah. So this is a company who is giving an application for the removal of its own name from the register. Fine. Can you give that application? Section 248 says you can definitely make such application. So fair enough. Then what? On the complaint of certain members, the registrar came to know that the company had already made an application which is pending. So you already made an application earlier. Oh my God. You already made an application earlier. This earlier application was for removal of name. Let us see. For the sanctioning of, this earlier application was for compromise arrangement. Okay. So if you know the points, if you know the logic, what they are saying, you want to remove the name of the company from the register of ROC. Fine. But when you are saying we want to remove the name of the company from the register of ROC, at the same time, you have already made an application to the ROC, telling the ROC, requesting the ROC, 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 we are making an application to the tribunal to help us in compromise arrangement. We want to do some compromise arrangement. So we have made application to the tribunal for compromise arrangement under section 230. Correct? So we have already done that. Now, if you have already made an application under section 230, or if you are already under insolvency bankruptcy code, your insolvency proceedings, corporate insolvency resolution process or liquidation process is going on, at that particular time, again, can you make such applications? Yes or no? Answer is, sir, absolutely not. So that application is only wrong. You are not allowed to make such applications. Yes or no? But sir, now, as per the information given, they have already made the application. So what should happen to them? What will happen to them? Application will be rejected. But sir, fake application, should they not be punished for it? Well. I think, yes, they should be punished for it. So how much is the punishment? That is given in 249. Correct section. So let's go one by one. The application was filed by the Fame Limited 2 months before the filing. 2 months before the filing of this application. So, okay. First thing is compromise arrangement application is pending. That is one thing. correct? And the second is 2 months they have given. Now, if you read the section very clearly, the period given over there is 3 months. Sir, where is it? Show now. Okay. Let me show you. See, what is this? Section 248. Can you see? Yes, power to make compromise and arrangement. Correct. Now, if you see 248, hear what they are saying. Company may itself make an application. Special resolution is passed. Yes, so that is okay, not a problem. But 249 restriction. What is the restriction? 3 months. You cannot make an application under 248 if within 3 months, last 3 months, any one of the five things are attracted. Now, any one of the five things are attracted. If you see our case, this point is attracted. Compromise arrangement application made 2 months before the date of application. Yes or no? Everybody. Okay. So, apparently, these are the 5 points. They are on your screen. Let me request you, please read them. Please read them once. And once you read them, you will realize that when we do the answer, the points are copy-paste. Exactly how they are given over here. Exactly how they are given over here. Understood? So, please go through them once. Okay. I'll wait for you. Yeah. Done. Penalty also is specified over here. 1 lakh rupees. Application shall be withdrawn by the company and rejected by the ROC. Let's go to the answers. According to section 248.2, after extinguishing all the liabilities, what they say? Company may make application. Yes or no? Yes. Special resolution. Did we read that? Yes. Or a consent of 75%, either or ways, correct? Now. You have to cause a public notice to be given. If you remember, all these points are here. 248.2. Correct? Company can make application, may. Correct? Special resolution, yes. Public notice required. So everything is covered. Then, as per section 249, there are certain restrictions to make application, correct? If in the previous 3 months, I showed you 3 months also, yes friends, I showed you 3 months also, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the 5 points also I had shown you. Let me increase the brightness for you. Yeah. So yes, these 5 points are there, wherein you cannot make an application. And this was the point, the fourth point over there also, which I marked. Yes or no? So we have done that marking also in our notes, which says that company has violated the provision. Correct? Now, if the company has violated the provisions, what should be done? Penalty. How much penalty did we see? 1 lakh rupees. Everything is the same. Everything is from our notes. Okay. Fine. So here we have answered the first question. Let's see what is the second one. File is loading. Please hold on. Okay. some issue with the loading, but anyways, let me show you the second one over here itself. What are they saying over here? They are saying rights. Computer is misbehaving. Yeah, here we are. So the second question was consequences if he files an application. So we have already seen the consequences also. Next it is, in case the registrar notifies Fame Limited as dissolved. Okay, so registrar has decided that this particular company shall be notified as dissolved, already dissolved under 248 in the compliances to the required provisions, then what is the remedy available to the aggrieved party? Now, if you are the aggrieved party, then what are the remedies available to you? If you are the aggrieved party, what will be the remedy available to you? Sir, very, 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 very simple concept. How simple? What is the remedy available to you? Imagine, you think, what is the remedy available? What will be the remedy? Section 252. I am aggrieved party. Aggrieved party, name of my company has been removed, dissolved, they are saying. So what I will do? I will file an appeal to the tribunal for the restoration of the name of the company. Yes or no? Correct. So let's see what answer they have given. Aggrieved party may file an appeal against the order. Exactly. Yes. So as we said, section 252, any person aggrieved by the order of the registrar who is dissolving the company, appeal to the tribunal, most important point, within a period of 3 years. Yes or no? Within a period of 3 years. So that is the main crux of this particular section. Then here we have given the provisions. Okay. Provisions as to how this whole answer should be actually there if at all you want to cancel the name of your company from the register of ROC. So if you want to do that, how can you do that? That is something we have tried to explain below this. So according to the provisions for the following answers, what is this? From here, if you see, according to the provisions, according to the above provisions, following are the answers. Three questions they asked, three answers again we have written. So practically here we already specified as per my textbook, as per institute's material, as per Bayer Act, what is the provision. From here itself, all the provisions exactly word to word same thing is there. And considering those things, here are the answers. 1, 2, and 3. You can go through the answers. If the provision is clear, answer is not a problem at all. Understood? Anybody can understand these answers. Correct? Now, let's go to the next part. What is the next question? Draft a board resolution of disclosure of interest by Mr. J, the director of ABC Limited, in a proposed contract to be entered into with Messrs. APL and Company, in which such director is a partner. Okay. So you have a particular director who is a partner in some company. Okay. And so naturally interest is there and you have to make a disclosure. Fine. Board resolution you have to draft. This is the easiest question, I would say. Okay. This is the easiest question. So such questions normally, I don't know if they will ask in the exam, because if they ask, it is bonus. 4 to 5 marks question, bonus. Nobody can take these marks away from you. Understood? Let's see. Drafting. How to draft a resolution also we have done in the class. Correct? And how to draft a resolution, that also I have given in the summary notes that you are referring to. Yes? So this is the board resolution. Any resolution that you draft shall begin with the words resolved that. So as you can see, the resolution begins with the words resolved that. Correct? Any resolution that you draft, quoting of the sections is compulsory. If you remember, quoting of section is compulsory. Here what is there? There is an interest of this particular director. So interest, disclosure of interest given under section 184. Disclosure of interest with the directors. Correct? So that is also given. And other applicable provisions of 2013. General notice. This is what? We are giving a general notice of the disclosure of interest or concern in form MVP1. Try to remember the forms if you can. If you can't, don't write wrong ones. Okay. So received from Mr. J of the company as placed before the meeting, be and hereby noted and taken on the record by the board. Meaning what? They are giving an acknowledgement that we have received an intimation from Mr. J that he is an interested party and it has been recorded by the board. Means it is noted. Correct? What after that? After that, they are saying, resolved that further, Mr. J, director of the company, and Mr. whatever, the company secretary, again and again, by banging on your head, I have said this in the class. If any name is not given, do not write the name. Correct? Write it blank like this. Keep it blank, Mr. Dash. If any names are given, use the names compulsory. If any names are not given, kindly do not write the names of your favorite actors or actresses or your friends or relatives over here, because it can be considered as a copy case. And I'm sure that is the last thing you want to happen to you in this pandemic. Yes, absolutely. So, what is the procedure over here? Now see, guys, I've always told this in the class also. Again, I'm telling it to you. Whenever you are writing any particular resolution, drafting any resolution, first paragraph, second paragraph, whatever you have to draft, it is given in the question. First paragraph, standard. Once that is resolved, you will start the second paragraph by the words further resolved that or resolved further that. Okay, any words you can use. But sir, what to resolve? In the question, they have given only one thing. I know, they have given only one thing. So when there is only one thing given in the question, the second paragraph, that is the last paragraph over here, will be standard. Standard means what? When you are doing anything in your company, you have to intimate the ROC. Correct? Now, if anything is happening in Reliance, you think Mukesh Ambani is going to go to ROC to intimate? Mukesh Ambani is not going to go to the ROC to intimate. Then his company secretary will go on his behalf. So, has the company given the power to CS to represent the company on behalf of it? Yes or no? So, that is where your second last or last paragraph will come, where you are giving power to the CS of the company. Correct? And lastly, there is a third point which was newly added over here, a new and a further resolved that. Okay, again the words further resolved that will be used. And what will you be doing over here? Over here, you will say this company secretary that we are sending. Okay, and Mr. J of the company, yes, who is the director, has given disclosure. They have the power to use what? Digital signature certificate. FX, the digital signature certificate, and file e-form MGT-14. What is MGT-14? MGT-14 is the form for whenever you pass any special resolution. Okay, for approvals, you pass any board resolutions also. Okay, certain specific resolutions. So that is where you file MGT-14 with the ROC. So for fixing digital signature certificate and filing form MGT-14, we have given the powers over here. Clear, everybody? Yes. So this is the resolution that you have to draft, and this is how you have to draft the resolution. All right. It is on your screen also, and it may be with you in your RTP also. So you can just quickly refer to the notes. Meanwhile, I will switch on to the next question. What is the next question? Question number 12. Okay. Can I start? Enumerate the given situations in the light of the term defined as current account or transactions under FEMA. Eh? What is this question? What do they want me to do? Enumerate the given situations in the light of the term defined as current account transactions under FEMA. 1, 2, 3. So basically what they want you to do is, they want you to identify whether these transactions are current account transactions or not. Lovely, simple, fantastic this is. Yes or no? I mean, how can you expect anything more easier than this? Yes, how can you expect anything to be more easier than this? They have given you three type of transactions, and all you have to do is simply identify if it is a current account transaction under FEMA or not. That's it. Correct. So for that, how will you identify? Let's see. How will you identify? Okay. So for identifying that, you need to first go to FEMA, current account transactions. Everybody, go to FEMA, current account transactions. Yes. I'm just adjusting the issue with the light. Okay, yeah, perfect. Go to FEMA current account transactions, and as you go to FEMA, the current account transactions, you will see there are rule 3, rule 4 and rule 5 transactions in FEMA, correct? Now this rule 3, rule 4 and rule 5 transactions which are given in FEMA current account transactions, note this point very clearly. Rule 3, prohibited transactions. Rule 4, restricted transactions. And rule 5, allowed subject to RBI approval if you cross the limit, correct? Okay, so we have done all the transactions in the class also. Okay, I'm not going through all the transactions right now, of course. What we have said, every time when we do this in the class, okay, there are nearly 25 transactions that we have marked over there. And every time, every student has to ask me that, sir, are there only 25 transactions in current account? And always my answer is no. First lot of transactions in rule 3 are prohibited ones. Second lot is restricted ones, and third lot is where you need specifically RBI approval after you cross the limits. Correct. So these are the three tranches. These are the three tranches, you know, how they are divided. Other than this, current account transactions are any transactions wherein you are going to do in the ordinary course of your business, for which are not given in rule 3, rule 4, rule 5, they are allowed. Yes or no? They are not given in rule 3, rule 4, rule 5 means they are openly allowed. Yes, everybody clear? Okay. So now let's see. A resident imports machinery from a vendor in UK for installing in his factory. I have a factory. I have a factory. I am importing the machine. I have a factory. I am importing the machine from UK. And I am installing it in my factory. Is it my business transaction? Yes. Does it happen in the ordinary course of business? Yes. Machinery import required in the factory? Yes. I can buy it from here. I am buying from there. So when it is coming in India, did I pay the import duty? Yes. Correct. So ordinary course of business? Yes. Is there any problem with this transaction? No. Is this a current account transaction? Definitely yes. Yes. So for the first question, my answer is, whether it is a current account transaction, my answer is yes, it is. A resident imports machinery from a vendor in UK for installing in his factory for a credit period of 3 months. Okay, so here they are saying you are a resident of India. Yes. You are importing machine. Yes. You are importing machine from outside India. Yes, that is import, obviously. Okay, so it is an international import. Have you paid the money? No. So you have not paid the money, meaning foreign exchange management regulations may be attracted. Yes. So why have you not paid the money? Because I have taken the machine on a credit period of 3 months, and in ordinary course of business, we make the money in 3 months in our type of business. Yes or no? So did I do anything wrong first of all by importing the machine? No, sir. So if I have not done anything wrong by importing the machine, in that case, should anybody have problem with this? So well, my vote over here also is little bit on yes side only. Correct. We will figure it out. A resident, Indian resident, transfers $1,000 to his NRI brother in New York as a gift. Oh, I did that just today. I transferred some funds to my brother who is outside India. Yes or no? Just kidding. I don't have funds to transfer. Anyways, jokes apart. The funds are sent from resident's Indian bank account to the NRI brother's foreign bank account, which is in New York. Is this a current account transaction? Let's identify. Money is being transferred. Yes. So money is going from Indian account. Yes. Money is going to foreign account. Yes. So it left from here, it reached there. gone for my brother who is my relative. So what is the problem? Let me see. Say rule 3, rule 4, rule 5. Are there any restrictions, prohibitions or approval requirements given over there? Yes or no? Nothing. Yes or no? And even if it is there, my funds are only $1,000. Any amounts with respect to imports or prices which you are distributing or something, 2.5 lakhs is liberalized remittance scheme allowed anywhere. Correct? So, I have a gut feeling. Here also it should be yes. Yes, but we don't work on gut feelings. Let's identify the answers. My all three votes for the question number 12 are yes. So what does the answer has to say? Let's see. First one. An Indian resident imports machinery from a vendor in UK for installing in his factory. What are they saying? First one. Hence, the transaction is a current account transaction. I'm just seeing whether my answer is correct or not. Correct? So, yes, my answer is correct over here. Very much. Fine. Good enough. Let's see the second one also. Hence, import on machinery on credit terms is a current account transaction. This was the only point where we had more doubts. We will see the logic also. Okay. And third one. Hence, it is a current account transaction. Sorted. Perfect. No problem at all. 3 points, all three are current account transactions. Correct? Now, let's go through the answers once. As per accounts and income tax, machinery is a capital expenditure. However, in FEMA, it does not alter. How does it matter? Okay, this is not income tax paper. And it does not alter an asset in India for a UK vendor. It does not create any liability to the UK vendor or the Indian importer, for the Indian importer, right? So once the payment is made by the Indian resident to that UK vendor, neither I owe anything to him, nor does he. So everybody is sorted. So it is ordinary course of business, ordinary transaction. It is a current account transaction. Similar logic again, correct? And the third one, however, under FEMA, they are saying once a gift is accepted by the NRI, no one owes anything to anybody. Yes. So once the gift is given and it is accepted, my transaction is over and it is a one-time transaction. It is a current account transaction. Clear, everybody? Yes or no? So simple enough, I guess that was correct. So we have done question number 12 also. Now we need to jump on to question number 13. Okay. Now, question number 13 talks about money laundering. Fine. Let's talk about question number 13. Okay. So, let's continue with question number 13 now. Okay. Question number 13. Mr. X was found to be guilty of money laundering. So, fine. We have at least identified the chapter. So, this particular question comes from the Prevention of Money Laundering Act. Okay. By being involved in an activity concerned with the connected with the proceeds of crime. Yeah, that is money laundering. Adjudicating authority, as per the findings, confirmed attachment of the property. Okay, so there is an adjudicating authority who has done what? The adjudicating authority has attached the property of this particular person, Mr. X. So attachment of the property has happened and ordered for the investigation. Fair enough. Investigation was initiated by the adjudicating authority on 1st February 2019. Okay. And the attachment of the property was to be continued, was still to be continued by 31st January 2020. 31st January, 1st February. So it's 1 year. Yes, it is 1 year time. Okay. Enumerate in the given situation the validity of the attachment period. All right. So what is the question over here? The big question over here is what is the attachment period? So, if you have done the Money Laundering Act, you might be aware the attachment period shall be 365 days max. Yes, or similar provision. Yes, if you are confused. Correct. So, let's verify. Okay. So, let's verify the answer. Question number 13. Yes. Order for the attachment of the property. Okay. As per Section 8 of the Money Laundering Act, adjudicating authority decides to attach any property involved in money laundering, by an order in writing, confirm the attachment of the property, record, freeze, frozen, Section 8 of the effect, period for attachment. So first paragraph, what they are saying, they are only saying a general point that adjudicating authority has the power to pass an order for freezing any particular property, correct? Okay. Secondly, now what they are saying, period of attachment, retention, freezing of the seized asset. How much is the period? Not exceeding 365 days. Or the pendency of the proceedings relating to any offense, correct? Okay. So after this, what are they trying to say? After this, they are trying to say, become final after the order of order of confiscation is passed. Okay, under Section 8 and Section 58. Okay, for the purpose of computing 365 days under Clause A, the period during which the investigation is stayed. So, if at all in this particular period they gave you a period like from 1st February 2019. Till 31st of March 2020. Okay, 1st February 2019 to 31st of March 2020, they had held the asset, confiscated the asset, seized the asset. So is the period valid? It is more than 365 days. So apparently, because it is more than 365 days, period is not valid. Correct. But if they say from 1st February 2019 to 31st of March 2020, where there was a stay order for 4 months. Stay order, so that particular period has to be excluded. That period has to be excluded from here. Understood? So once that period is excluded, you are well within 365 days and your answer is correct. Correct? All right. So accordingly, the attachment of the property of Mr. X to be continued till by 31st January 2020 is valid as it is within 365 days. Correct, everybody? So that is your very, very simple answer. Yes, it may come for 2 to 4 marks max. It's very, very simple answer. Only you have to remember it 365 days over here, which is important. Correct? All right, let's go to the next part. Okay, question number 40. ABZ Limited. ABZ Limited is an unlisted company with a total assets of 1 crore as per financial statement as on 31st March 2018. Okay. Defaulted in the payment of the financial debt against a financial creditor. So financial debt, obviously, it will be against financial creditor only. Correct. Mr. X filed an application for the initiation of the insolvency process. Okay. So financial creditor, that is Mr. X, has filed an application that he wants to start the insolvency process on 31st May 2019. That is the date. Discuss the relevancy for the disposal through mechanism of fast track corporate insolvency resolution process. Fantastic. And the legal position of holding fast track corporate insolvency resolution process by Mr. X. Compute the time period for the completion. Now see, if at all you have seen my video lecture also, okay, which is available on YouTube for insolvency bankruptcy code, you might be aware. And if you are in my class, you've been in my class, then naturally you should be aware of this particular answer, because as I told you in the class also and on the YouTube video also, fast track corporate insolvency resolution process, when you see this particular words in your question, you have to be the happiest person. Like, this is the easiest answer from IBC chapter. Understood? This is the easiest answer from the IBC chapter. I will tell you why. Because when you read this particular answer from IBC chapter, you will notice that in the whole of the IBC, there is only one paragraph, one section exclusive for fast track. So all you have to do is just read that particular paragraph. And then any answer of fast track cannot be out of that. Understood. It has to be from within this particular part. Clear, everybody? Okay. So now, let's see what are the questions. First of all, they are asking, can Mr. X go for fast track insolvency for his client ABC Limited? That is your first question. Second, legal position for holding fast track insolvency. So what is the criteria for holding fast track insolvency? Correct. And third question, time period that is under fast track insolvency. Correct. So let's discuss. Yes. Fast track insolvency. Is it possible? Yeah, why not? There is an option. So is it available for each and every company? No. That option is not available for each and every company. If you have read the concept very clearly, it is clearly given that if you are a small company, yes, if you are a small company or a startup company, correct, then for such kind of companies, you may go for fast track, only for such kind of companies. Here they have given small company, no. But they have given you one information. They have given you, it is an unlisted company with total assets of rupees 1 crore. Now, if you go to section 2, subsection 85 of the Companies Act 2013, section 2, subsection 85 of Companies Act 2013 talk about the definition for small companies, which says that paid up share capital and turnover. Yes, paid up share capital and turnover limit specified 20 crores. Yes. 1 crore, sorry, not 20 crores, turnover 1 crore. Yes. So if you see the section very, very clearly, they have specified if your turnover is up to 1 crore, you can be classified as a small company. Here they have given you unlisted company, assets 1 crore. Okay. Did I say turnover? Sorry, my bad. Yes. So apparently this looks to be a small company as it qualifies the criteria given over there. Then the question is, how much time period should be given for fast track corporate insolvency resolution process? Fast track. See, normally, sir, we give 180 days. And for genuine reasons, extension can be granted for more 90 days. So it is 180 plus 90, correct? But if it is fast track, we will divide it by 2. We will divide it by 2. That is what norm. We will, for fast track, we will give only 90 days. And for genuine reasons, we will give extra 45 days. Correct. So that is what we have discussed. Now let us find out what they have to say. Fast track corporate insolvency process is a speedy process. Speedy process for the corporate insolvency resolution for small companies. Section 55 of IBC applicable. Section 55 of IBC, mark the section. Yes. How are they saying? Corporate debtors. With assets income below the limit notified by CG. Corporate debtors or such class of creditors with amount of debts as notified by CG. And others. This third point is what? Such other category. This is what? Others. Others as may be prescribed by CG. Correct? So what you have to remember over here, I will highlight the point for you. Yeah. So first of all, assets and income. Second of all, amount of debt. And third, others. This is all that you have to remember. Clear? Applicability. Small company, startup company. We already discussed. Yes. Total assets not exceeding 1 crore. See, unlisted company. Total assets not exceeding 1 crore. So that is a separate applicability point. Correct? So three things you have to remember. 1. Section 2. Subsection 85. Which is what? Small company. Correct? Small company. They have given you limits. I will write it over here. Paid up share capital. And turnover. Correct? Two limits are given for small companies. What is it? Paid up share capital, they have given 50 lakhs if I'm not wrong. Correct? And turnover, they have specified as 2 crores. Am I right? Let's confirm. Yes. Meanwhile, this is what we'll confirm. This is a startup company. What is a startup company? Startup company means a company whose turnover is not more than rupees 100 crores or 7 years of incorporation, whichever is earlier. So if you are 7 years of incorporation or over, you are no longer a startup company, correct? And if at all your 100 crores of the turnover has been reached, then you are no longer a startup company, correct? So yes, section 85, small company, paid up share capital 50 lakhs and turnover 2 crores, which is amended and increased to 10 crores now, correct? So not more than 10 crores. Everybody, this is 50 lakhs. With prior approval, you can increase it up to rupees 10 crores, correct? Meaning, even if you have it up to 10 crores paid up share capital, but if you have taken approvals, you will be still considered as a small company. And for the turnover, how much they are saying? As I had said earlier, 2 crores only. But again, with approval, you can increase it and take it up to 100 crores. Okay, so apparently this is not useful for us. What we discussed at the beginning stage is only important. Okay, so 50 lakhs and 2 crores, very standard limit that is. We have cross-checked from the Bayer Act. Okay, and that is correct. So either you are a small company or you are a startup company or you are third category they have said is unlisted company. Unlisted company whose total assets not more than rupees 1 crore. Everybody clear? Yes. So these are the conditions which you have to remember. Alright. So I'm putting it on the screen. Yeah. So these are the conditions which are given in the applicability of the provisions part which is on your screen. Correct? After that, time limit. Time limit is very, very simple. We have already discussed. Yes. 90 days. Extension 45 days. Perfect. So that is your answer. It is on your screen. Kindly go through it once. So we'll go to the next question. Very, very simple answer this was. Indeed. Yeah, go for it. You can just pause the video. Yes, and read this particular thing from your screen. Or if you have RTP in your hand, best. Nothing better than that. Okay. Let's go to the next question. That is question number 15. That says, Bharat Limited is a subsidiary of Global Limited, which is an MNC registered in Hong Kong. So Global Limited is a subsidiary which is registered in Hong Kong. Okay. And Bharat Limited is a subsidiary which is in India. The Bharat Limited had obtained the permission to receive foreign contribution in a designated bank account in SBI. So sounds like foreign contribution is coming inside India. So this belongs to your chapter Foreign Contribution Regulations Act, correct? So this particular answer belongs to the chapter Foreign Contribution Regulations Act, understood? And what does that chapter say? It clearly specifies that in case your foreign currency is coming inside India, it should come in one particular bank account only, yes? And that bank account should be with any scheduled commercial bank, correct? And then for utilization purpose, you can use it. You can use it anywhere, anyhow, anywhere, anytime in multiple accounts also. You can disburse it. But receiving always foreign contribution should be in one single account. That is also allowed for which particular person? Two types of persons. If you remember everything, I'm just repeating which we have done in class. Two types of persons we have talked about. First, a person who is registered, with the central government. Yes. For 5 years license he has, that he can operate, he can send money. Second is the person we have used the word OTR, one-time registration. One-time registration means prior approval, prior permission he has taken for every particular transaction that he wants to do. So either he is registered or he has taken prior permission. Registered means 5 years, prior permission means OTR, one-time registration. So prior permission or registration, prior permission or registration should be there. If it is there, he can accept the money which is coming any number of times. Yes, but if it is OTR, then one time. But in a scheduled commercial bank, only single account is allowed. After that, he can disburse the money, remove there and distribute it in multiple accounts. There is not a problem. But The banker's responsibility is also there to disclose certain things. Yes, source, amount, utilization. Yes or no? So when should the banker disclose these things? Yes, when should the banker disclose? If you remember, we have done it normally within 48 hours. Whenever the money is received or sent, within 48 hours, the banker has to disclose. Clear, everybody? So this is the basic concept. Let's see the question. What is the question first of all? Then we will figure out how many things are applicable over here. Bharat Limited had obtained permission, SBI. Okay, SBI, so it is a scheduled commercial bank only. Later it was discovered that the obtained foreign contributions were deposited in another account for its functioning. So you can do that later on. You can distribute to other accounts, not a problem. Advice on the given situation as to depositing of the foreign contribution from the designated account to any other account, whether it is allowed? Yes, it is allowed. And state the duty of the bank. Disclosure. Simple question. Simple question, I guess. Is it so simple? Every person who has been got granted a certificate, meaning registered, or prior permission, meaning OTR, correct? Receive foreign contribution, single account, we already said, correct? However, open one or more accounts. You may open one or more accounts in one or more banks for utilization. So that also we discussed, correct? Every bank or authorized person in the foreign exchange shall report to such authority as may be specified. What do they have to report? They give you duty of banks. Yeah, so what is the duty? First, prescribed amount of remittance, source and the manner of remittance, and others as may be prescribed. When do they have to disclose? I told you something like 48 hours. Let us see, as per the above provisions, foreign contribution should be received in one bank. If permission is obtained, you can designate an account. However, utilization is permissible. So that's all theory part. As per rule 16 of FCR, the bank shall report to the central government within 48 hours of any transaction. Exactly as we have discussed. Correct? So you can understand, if your concepts are clear, these things can be really, 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 really easy. Yes? All right. Fine. Let's go to the next question. SEBI. On a complaint of Mr. KG, inquired that Mr. Mehta, a CEO of the X Limited, on the basis of unpublished price sensitive information, insider trading question. Guys, especially if you are my students, you should wear a smile on your face, because SEBI penalties we have done in the class or in the videos with the help of a memory technique. Yes, alphabetically I had helped you to remember the SEBI penalties, where G stands for Gharwale, and Gharwale means insiders. Yes or no? So we have by-hearted the particularly, so 15G is the section that is, you can straight away write it over here. What do they want? Let us see. Examine on the basis of the said finding what action SEBI might take against Mr. X. What? Insider trading is there. So penalty of insider trading will come. Yes or no? Minimum that 10 lakh rupees, maximum much 3 times of the profit made, or 25 crores, whichever is higher. Simple section. Simple particular question. Yes or no? How do we write this? How do you write? You have to write the section number, and you have to write the penalty section number, that is 15G, and you have to write the whole definition of insider trading. Okay, whole definition of insider trading has to be written over here. Let's see what they have done. Section 15G, as expected, started with the section number. Correct? So, according to this, if any insider, see, this is what the definition of insider trading, as I told you. We will start with the definition. What will happen to him? Penalty given. Minimum 10 lakhs up to 25 crores or 3 times the amount, whichever is higher. Yes or no? So maximum penalty they have given, 25 crores or 3 times the amount of profits, whichever is higher. Tell me, how more simple can the question be? This is like a direct question which is given to you. Yes or no? So this is like the most easiest part. Yeah. Question number 17. Mr. R. All right, 17, yeah. Mr. R, the respondent, had placed an order of purchase of various quantities of phosphoric acid from Mr. P, a petitioner. Have you heard this somewhere? The purchase noted the terms and conditions as per Fertilizer Association of India. That FAI, terms and conditions for sale, purchase, phosphoric acid, clause 15, arbitration chapter, enumerate in the light of the given circumstances. Wait. Arbitration chapter is here. And do we have it over here in this file or not? I'm checking. See, arbitration chapter in front of you. This is from our summary notes. Yes, this is from our summary notes. This watermark which you can see, Harsh Kachalya, that is not there in the summary notes. So don't bother. You won't find difficulty in reading over there. Okay. This is the arbitration agreement through reference that we have talked about. Pay attention very clearly. This is exact example which is given in the study material also. Okay. And exact material has been used by the institute. No changes whatsoever have been done by them. Let's see over here. In other words, parties to an agreement. Wait, example, Group A, Chimnik Tunisian SA versus Southern Petrochemicals Industries Corporation Limited. Okay, Chimnik, at least you can remember Chimnik name, you remember. We will see whether they have given the same in the answer or not. Correct. This is what? This is arbitration agreement through reference. Correct. If you can remember, if you can just we read the question, understand Fertilizer Association of India phosphoric acid clause 15. These are exact same words which are given in my notes also, which are given in the institute material also. And that is why when I read the question, I felt like, man, this is something we have read somewhere. Exact words, exact same words, like bonus. Okay. Let's go again and figure out the answer. So basically what the question is, I will tell you. Question is, you have to identify whether it is a valid arbitration agreement between the parties or not. And if it is valid, then which type of agreement it is. Correct? So let me explain the case to you first. Yes. So basically what happened? There are two parties. Okay, between the two parties there is an agreement. Okay, between the two parties there is an agreement that what is the agreement? Agreement that we are going to charge or take our particular rate or make an understanding as per the points provided by the Fertilizer Association of India. Correct. Now, in case of dispute, what should they do? Answer is very simple. They should refer to the manual of the Fertilizer Association of India only. Correct. So whether they can refer in their arbitration agreement to some another Fertilizer Association of India's manual, yes or no? So we said, yeah, why not? It is mutual, and the arbitration means mutual understanding between the two people. Yes. So mutual understanding between the two people to refer to some another manual, okay, which is provided by the Fertilizer Association of India in this particular case. Yes or no? That is known as what? This is arbitration agreement through reference. Clear, everybody? Very simple. So, see, held by Supreme Court of India in Group Chimnik Tunisian and Southern Petrochemicals, same name. Yes or no? That what? It is an arbitration agreement through reference. Exact same thing I explained to you. Exact same thing on your screen. Correct? So, technically, this is your 17 and very, very simple answer. All right, get through with it. Then we go to question number 18. So guys, let's go to question number 18. Okay, what is question number 18? PQR Limited is holding 30% of the paid up equity capital of Cochin Stock Exchange. Okay, Cochin Stock Exchange. So 30% share capital is held by PQR Limited. Fair enough. This is the question with respect to a stock exchange. Okay. The company appoints MNL Limited as its proxy. PQR Limited is appointing MNL Limited as its proxy, who is not a member of the Cochin Stock Exchange, to attend and vote at the meeting of a stock exchange. Okay. So there is this company who cannot go and vote. Okay. So they are appointing another company to go and vote in a Cochin Stock Exchange. Understood? So whether that is allowed or not. Examine whether the Cochin Stock Exchange can restrict the appointment of MNL Limited as a proxy and further restrict voting rights of PQR Limited or not. Very simple this is sounding. Is it really simple? See, first of all, it is a question with respect to a stock exchange, correct? So, sir, it can be a company also, no? Yeah, it can be a company also, but they have specifically given that it is a Cochin Stock Exchange, and they have given whether Cochin Stock Exchange can restrict or not. So, whether a stock exchange can restrict or not, for that, we need to go to the chapter which is full of the details and all the concepts of a stock exchange. That is your Securities Contract Regulations Act 1956. As you go to SECRA, Securities Contract Regulations Act 1956, you will realize that there is a lot of short answers that we have done in the class, where one of the answers also talks about powers to make or amend its rules by the stock exchange. Yes or no? So stock exchange has the powers to make or amend its rules. So here, if they are asking, examine whether the stock exchange can restrict the appointment of MNL Limited and also restrict its voting rights, stock exchange has the power to make or amend its rules. So if stock exchange puts it in their powers, uses their powers, they can definitely make or amend. Yes or no? So my first answer over here will be yes, definitely. There should not be any problem. Correct? Let's see. Section 7A of Securities Contract Regulations Act provides that a recognized stock exchange is empowered to amend the rules, just as we discussed. Correct. So what are the rules they can do? With respect to restriction of voting rights to the members only, they can do that. Restriction of voting rights by specifying each member entitled to one vote irrespective of number of shares held. So one member, one vote. And lastly, here they are saying, restriction on rights to appoint a proxy, and lastly others as may be prescribed. Correct. So these are the powers. So definitely, if these are the powers that a stock exchange possesses with respect to amending its rules, then our two answers can restrict and can also restrict as per the given question. Yes. So very simple question, very simple answers. Perfect. Let's go to the next one. Mr. Mediator was proposed to be appointed as a resolution professional. Okay, so this is from Insolvency Bankruptcy Code. Mr. Mediator was proposed to be appointed as a resolution professional for the corporate insolvency resolution process, which is initiated against BMR Limited. Okay, so there is a company, BMR Limited. There is this person, Mr. Mediator. Okay, so Mr. Mediator is a person, BMR Limited is the company. Mr. Mediator is appointed as a resolution professional for BMR Limited. So what is the problem? Mr. R, who is Mr. R? Maybe somebody. Is a relative of a director of BMR Limited. Okay. Mr. R is a relative of some director of BMR Limited. So is a partner in the insolvency professional entity. So the firm from which Mr. Mediator is coming, Mr. R also belongs to that firm. He's a partner in that firm. Understood? And Mr. Mediator is also a part of that firm only. So he's also a partner or employee of the partner of the director. Correct? Mr. Mediator is a partner or employee of the partner or director of the company. So apparently he's a related party. Question is what? Examine the nature of the proposal of appointment of Mr. Mediator for the conduct of CIRP as per IBC. Not allowed. He is a relative as per the definition. Yes or no? Let's see. As per Regulation 3 of IBC, an insolvency professional shall be eligible to be appointed as a resolution professional for CIRP of a corporate debtor if he and all the partners and directors of the professional entity in which he is a partner or director are independent. In this, can you say Mr. Mediator is independent? No. He cannot be independent because Mr. R is there. Mr. R is a relative of the director, relative of the director of the company in which his entity is going to conduct the insolvency proceedings. Correct? So, here we have given the meaning of independent. Okay, like we have given section 149 of Companies Act 2013. The basic information is given here, A, B, C points. Understood? As per the given facts, Mr. Mediator was proposed to be appointed as a resolution professional initiated against BMR Limited. Yes, perfect. Whereas Mr. R is a relative of a director of BMR Limited, is a partner in the insolvency professional entity, in which mediator is also a partner. So, he's a partner of the partner or director or relative of employee. Confused. Since Mr. R is the partner in the entity in which Mr. ED mediator is also a partner. Okay. So, Mr. Mediator is not eligible for the appointment as a resolution professional, as he is not independent of the corporate debtor. But natural, no. I am a partner. You are a partner. Okay. We both are the partner of firm A Limited. Correct? Okay. The ABC and company. Okay. ABC and company is a firm. We both are partners. We got a client, let's say X Limited. We are ABC and company. We got a client X Limited. Your relative is a director in X Limited. Can you go to conduct the audit of X Limited? Correct? Can I go to conduct the audit? No. Why? Because if partner is disqualified, the whole firm is disqualified. Yes or no? So definitely Mr. Mediator cannot go. Let's go to the last question. In the AGM of XYZ Limited, while discussing on the matter of retirement and reappointment of the director, Mr. X allegations of Mr. X, allegations of fraud and financial irregularities were marked against him by some members. It resulted into the chaos. The situation was normal only after the chairman declared about initiating an inquiry against Mr. X, against the director. Correct? So Mr. X, however, could not be reappointed in the meeting. Could not be reappointed. Okay. The matter was published in the newspapers next day. On the basis of such news, whether a court can take the cognizance of the matter and take an action against the director on its own, justify your answer. This is a very, very simple answer if you have understood the question first. Okay, I'll show you afterwards. What they are saying is, it is a question with respect to inspection, inquiry, investigation related part. Okay, so what is happening over here? First of all, understand that. What is happening over here is, a little part of adjudication of special courts and little part of inspection, inquiry, investigation. Analytically, if you analyze, you will understand. What is happening is, there is some problem which has happened in the company. Okay, with respect to appointment of director or some kind of a chaos and things. So those things keep on happening. I mean, it's a company, so problems keep on coming and going. But now what is the problem over here? This particular issue which took place in the company, it came in the newspapers the next day. This particular issue which happened in the company, it came in the newspapers in the next day. So the court read the newspaper. Yes, the judicial authorities read the newspaper, and by that they are like, we will take an action against the director of the company. The question is very simple. Simply by an advertisement which has come in the newspaper, can the judicial authority take an action against any director or any person of the company or not? Simple question. Yes or no? Answer is, sir, definitely on the basis of a newspaper advertisement, how can it be done? Yes or no? So let's see what the answer has to say over here. as per Section 439 of the Companies Act 2013. Correct? It provides of the offences, saying that it shall all be non-cognizable. Plus, every offence under this Act, except for those which are referred in Section 212, subsection 6. What are 212, subsection 6? Those offences which require penalty under Section 447. We have marked it with the red pen in the class, if you remember. Remove your class notes of inspection inquiry and check it under this particular section. We have marked it with a red pen. You have also written over there Section 447 penalties. No court shall take cognizance of any offence. Very, very clear language. Yes. No court shall take cognizance of any offence. So we don't even have to read anything further. This is the provision. You cannot change the language over here. This is the provision. This has to be as it is. This is the conclusion. What does the conclusion say? Conclusion says, thus, in the given situation, court shall not suo moto take any action. On its own, court cannot take any action. Definitely. I mean, you are a court after all. How can you take any action on your own? Unless anybody files a complaint. Correct? So, any action on Mr. X without receiving any complaint from the ROCs, shareholder of the company, or any person authorized by CG on their behalf. Alright. So, that was the last question that we had to discuss from the RTP. And with this, we are successfully finishing the discussion of the RTP, which is applicable for your upcoming exams. Yes. This is what I want to zoom over here. May 2020, correct? Which is no more May 2020, but it may be July 2020. Understood? So let's hope that if exams are held, then all of you be safe and attempt the exams very, very perfectly. My apologies, I couldn't come earlier because you know how the situation is there around here. Mumbai, I'm from Mumbai, so it's not even a red zone, it is dark red zone over here. Correct? So we are all under containment, and just today I got an opportunity, so I immediately recorded this stuff and brought it for you. I hope it was helpful. Yes, and if you need anything else, all of you, you have my number, or at least you have the number which is being displayed on the screen. So feel free to contact me for any notes you want, textbook you want, summary notes you want, or whatever you want. Video lectures you want, pen drive you want, Google Drive you want, whatever you want, feel free to contact me. Okay, I will do each and everything that is possible for me. All the very best. God bless you all. Thank you.
If you like this video, share it with your friends. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to watch more such videos and learn from our expert faculty members. Press the bell icon to get regular notifications whenever we upload a new video. Download NDI mobile app to get complete CA course online. We value your support. Thank you for watching.